Matthew 5:28. But I say unto you, that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her hath committed adultery with her in his heart. Romans chapter 1, verse 24, 25, 26, and 27. Wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie, and worshiped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is a blessed God forever. Amen. For this cause God gave them up unto vile affections. For even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature, and likewise also the men. God's against it. God hates it. God hates it. God hates it. You know, it's about time we started hating some sin. Well, I'm not for hating the sinner, but I'm for hating the sin. God hates it. It's destroying our country. It's destroying our families. It's destroying our churches. It's destroying our children. It's destroying our marriages. What are we going to do about it? Are we going to be pacifists about it? Are we going to examine it like some of you do as you drive down the highway, checking out the billboard 2 and 3 and 4 times and sneaking a look over the counter down the store where you see the filthy books and you listen to the music and you never do anything about it? If you're God's man, get up and do something about it. You're not going to change this nation if you live like them. Guard your mind. Guard it. Keep it pure. Keep it holy. So what should we do? What should we do? Number one, realize nobody starts out as a weird, unnatural porno addict. They start out with a little lust. Just a little lust. It's all it takes. Just a touch. And you let it run. You let it run wild. Gets up its energy. What you thought you would control soon controls you. Little second look. Dirty thought. Protect your mind. Protect your mind. Realize nobody starts out weird. They develop it. Just a little bit at a time. The devil doesn't come to someone and say, sign this contract. It's a contract for a full-fledged pervert. He comes to you and he shows you just one sentence on it. And you say, I'm not going to stay long. I'll drop by and visit. And you visit it again and again and again and again. Guard your mind. Be holy. Be pure. Realize nobody starts out as a weird, unnatural porno addict. Number two, if you have controlled your lust thus far, don't change. Don't change. Don't stop controlling yourself. Believe me, folks, most of you are at the last stage before you go out into the ministry to be pastors and assistant pastors. And the devil's thinking, I got to get him now. I've got to get him now. He may want you more now than ever. Don't give in. It's worth it. Some of your parents helped you to protect your mind, but you're not with your mom and dad anymore. They took you everywhere. You were everywhere with them, but finally you're on your own and you're out away from them, and we can only control you so much. By the way, let me say this about that man that I told you of earlier that graduated from our college. We're disgusted with that. We're disappointed in that. And if there were only one, one's too many. We never want that to happen, and I hope he's the only one. That's why I'm here today saying to you, protect your mind. Protect your mind.
Abba, Father, I need more of you, Holy Spirit.
His thoughts are not our thoughts. His ways are not our ways. And for a few of you, it's been so long since you heard anybody just tell how it was. You just, it's in sugar-coated. I apologize. I forgot my sugar. I've only got so much time. It's hard to cram 5 hours worth of message into 30 minutes. Hey, don't think you're above it. That's part of that, the beginning of the contract. He comes, he says, look, you don't have to become a pervert. Get involved a little bit here. You're strong enough to dabble, not end up in its depths. That's a lie of the devil. Flee youthful lust. What's that mean? Run! 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 I'm glad Joseph ran! Boy, when you get anywhere near it, run! Run! Panic! Get out of there! Somebody, you see somebody's got a book or something that's filthy, run! Run from it! Some of you, where you work, you need to take another path to your workstation. Take another path. Some guy in his toolbox got a filthy picture. Don't go by that toolbox anymore. Climb across the top of the building and climb in a window on the other side, but stay away from the garbage. Some of you need to take a new path on your way to work. Say, take me 3 minutes longer. It might keep you pure in eternity. It's a long time, by the way, too. Protect yourself. Stay away from it. Run from it. Flee it. Because if you've guarded yourself thus far, keep up the good work. It's worth it. Allowed lust to roam freely in the quarters of your mind, in the quarters of your heart, attack it immediately. Attack it. Don't just say, well, let's see what happens. I'll tell you what will happen. All the things I just told you would happen. It will happen. What do? You attack it. You attack it like a germ or like a virus. You attack it like you would a snake, because I guarantee you it's from the snake. It's from the serpent. And you'll either go after it or it'll poison you. You've got to attack it. You've got to start today. You've got to decide, okay, I've seen some things. Some things have happened to me. Some things have happened in my mind. I've got to do something about it. And you attack it. See, what you've already done is done, and we can't change that. But let's start fixing it. From here on out, what are we going to do? We're going to be pure. From here on out, what are we going to do? We're going to live purely and honestly and wholly. From here on out, that's the best any of us can do. From here on out, everybody here has seen things you shouldn't have seen. From here on out, we're going to protect our eyes and protect our minds. What do I do, Brother Owens? I think that you ought to memorize every scripture that you can on the topic of lust, self-control, purity, holiness. You see, you overcome evil with good. Psalm 119:11 says, thy word have I hid mine heart that I might not sin against thee. Memorize a scripture that refutes your weakness. The word of God will come to your aid. The word of God will change things. You understand the battle is battle for territory. Picture your mind. Great big circle, here's your mind. Whatever you put in it, it's there. But what are we going to do? We're going to put abundance of good in it. And you'll overcome that evil that claims some territory in your mind. Will overcome it with so much good that when you reach into your mind to pull something out, it will be good rather than evil.
Number four, go to someone for help. Go to someone for help. He said, I'd be embarrassed. Not as much as what you're going to be. He said to me, I didn't know who to go to for help. I was afraid of the embarrassment. I said, now how do you feel? You're out of the ministry completely. Probably going to lose your wife and kids and everything else. Now how embarrassed are you? I'd trade in a little embarrassment now and get a lot of help and save a ministry. Go to someone for help.
Deliver me, your strength inside me. All of my life I've been in hiding, wishing there was someone just like you. Now that you're
number five. If you have in your possession or at your access anything related to pornography, destroy it immediately. Destroy it immediately. Many of you, and I doubt that anybody has anything like that, but I'm going to tell you something. If you do, you'll have the strength after a message like this, because the Word of God has been preached. You'll have the strength to get it, destroy it, and do away with it, but you just wait just a few days. Convince yourself, oh, well, I'll get to it. It'll get to you. The Word of God will lead you to repentance, and some of you are hearing it. You better take care of the thing before it takes care of you. If something that you have causes you to lust, get away from it. Run from it. Destroy it. If it's some catalog that you have and you say, that catalog, and I'm talking about a clothing catalog from some department store. If that catalog, you say, Brother Owens, the college would allow me to have it. Now, we wouldn't allow you to have it if it had something in it that would cause you to lust. And even if it is not obviously something that would cause everybody else to lust, if it's causing you to lust, burn it. Get rid of it. The devil uses different tools on different people. You say, well, I don't think anybody else thinks that's wrong, but if it's wrong for you, get rid of it. Get rid of it.
Now that you're here, now that I've found you, I know that you're the one to pull me through. All of my life, I've been in hiding, wishing there was someone just like you. Now that you're here.
Some of you have pictures of old boyfriends and girlfriends that you used to sleep with. It's time to burn them. I promise you, that's going to haunt you. You're not going to overcome this thing unless you make some drastic changes. That. I hope I can say this and not be vain. I'm just getting started at this, but I'm not as much a novice as you are at it. I've counseled a lot of people through things like this. A victory's available. But it's not going to come easily. You're going to have to attack. Attack it. Attack it. Attack it. I'll guarantee you it's attacking you.
Jesus, Jesus, how I trust you, how I've proved to all and all. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus. Deliver me.
Number six, beg God. Beg God for the mind of Christ. Beg God for the mind of Christ. Philippians 2:5 says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. I promise you, if you'll beg God to control your mind and beg God for his mind, Jesus does not lust. And you begin to think his way. You know, some of you guys could control some of your lust. You begin to think the way God thinks, even if a woman is immodestly dressed. As you look, you could say, you know, that's a soul that needs to be saved. She's bound by sin. Won't you start praying for the people you lust for? Won't you realize you're busy lusting their body and they're busy going to hell? The the mind of Christ. See, the mind of Christ is pure. Some of you say, I've never heard anything like this before. It's too bad.
That's right.
It's too bad.
Deliver me. Courage to guide me. Deliver me. Your strength inside me. All of my life, I've been in hiding.
Lastly, make a covenant with your eyes. Make a covenant with your eyes. Job said in Job 31:1, I made a covenant with mine eyes. Why then should I think upon a maid? You and your eyes need to make a promise, an agreement to each other. You need to say to your eyes, you won't look at anything pornographic or anything that would cause you to lust. Make a promise from this day out. And you say, and if something accidentally comes before my eyes, I'll not look a second time. That's a promise I'm making. Between me and God and my eyes, I'm promising God from this day forth, my eyes will be pure eyes. My eyes will look at nothing that Jesus Christ himself would not look at. Today, you need to make a covenant with your eyes.
Deliver me, this cross that I'm bearing. What a friend I found, closer than a brother.
I stand up here and I preach on holiness and it goes in one ear and out the other. I stand up here and preach on separation and I'm telling you folks, you better not sit on that pew and grow cold and lose the presence of God. And you can do it if you don't guard your walk. The Lord took me to the book of Genesis and he said, notice what Noah did in the ark. He opened up the window after the flood and he sent the raven out. And the raven went out, and the raven is carnivorous. It lives off dead things. And it flew out, and the Bible said the raven found a place to rest the soles of his feet. What did it rest them on? There was nothing on the planet except bloated, putrefied, dead bodies.
Jesus. Jesus. Friend forever.
I can see that old raven, unclean, flying out of the church service. Bye, preacher. Woo! Thank God that service is over. He sure preached long enough. I was having a nicotine fit. My God. Fasting. Fasting. I'm going to eat like a pig. Fasting. And he looks down and he sees dead things. And he flies down on some old putrefied floating carcass and sinks down ankle deep in it and sits there and starts eating and picking that old bloated cow to pieces, eating its innards. Then the dove flies out of the ark and the dove looks down and I can see that old raven. It's my sermon. I can preach it like I want to. And I can see that old raven ankle deep in feeding on dead things. I got to preach right there just 1 minute. Your feet aren't going to be clean if all week long you feed on dead things like HBO and Cinemax and pornography and worldly music and this and that and this soap opera and that worldly show and that little homosexual program that makes you giggle. raven. I can see that old raven just tearing it all to pieces. And he looks up, hawk, hawk, dove, come on over here and eat some of this. Dove flutters over. Oh no, the Bible said he could find no place to rest the soles of his feet. Turned around and said, my feet aren't going to touch that. Flew back inside the window and said, old preacher, I know this ark is confining. I know that there are rules and regulations and we eat the same old thing, but I got news for you. It's the best place on this planet for me. Lord, feed me from heaven. Feed me from your word. I don't want to eat on dead things. Whatsoever things are pure, just, and lovely, and if there be any praise, and if there be any virtue, think on these things. Our walk. Jeremiah 6 said God gave them the food of their thoughts, which means if your mind thinks on stuff long enough, you will become it. But when you take in the word of God, it washes you. It cleanses you. That's why, friends, it is a sin, an absolute sin, to sit and not read this book, but be entertained by dead things. And you haven't found time to read this book. They were worshipers and they understood if we're going to have God's presence, it's not something we pay people to do on the platform for us. That is our problem in America. We pay everybody so we don't have to do nothing in worship to the Lord. We'll buy a bus and put gas in it and nobody will drive it. Because that's how we soothe our conscience. We will sit up in the balcony. I paid that boy to lead in worship. Let him worship for me. And we have lost our worship in service unto God. We want, preacher, go visit my sick relatives. I ain't going. I pay you to do that. Isn't that amazing? And so what you do is you substitute and give your money instead of your worship unto God. Worship is not singing a song. It's a lifestyle. When these people are shaking hands at the front door, they are worshiping God. When these ushers are passing the place, they are worshiping God. Worship involves you doing something. But boy, we better never forget that we don't play games with God and go to church and live an ungodly life. Holy, holy, holy. And when you start worshiping Him, see, it's more than getting happy and clappy on Sunday morning. Woo! Look at the lights. Woo! Happy and clappy Christians are filling auditoriums by the thousands today, and then they walk out and live an unclean life. It's more than happy and clappy. You better live holy.
That won't put your candle out. Find somebody that won't pull you the wrong way. Find somebody, help me preach a few minutes. Find somebody that won't try to get you in sin. Try somebody that won't get you to rebel against your parents. Try to find some friends that'll encourage and strengthen and stir your walk with God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you're getting on a new job, I'm talking to adults now. That first thing you do, you choose the wrong friends. Oh, brother, and you gotta be good to everybody. Yeah, you gotta be good to everybody, but you don't have to open your heart up to everybody. You've got to be careful. Either you'll influence them or they'll influence you. Affect them or they'll affect you. Either you'll lead them or you'll follow them, but they will affect you one way or the other. So starting out tomorrow, you may have to choose some different friends. Hallelujah. There are a lot of junk in schools that used to not be there. We homeschool everybody. Don't do that or get to do that or have a desire to do that. We love it. Whatever your choice is, your children are just as precious as anybody else's. Moms and daddies, you ought to lay hands on your children. You ought to pray on them. You ought to tell the devil, it's my child. Hallelujah. I give birth to it to take it to heaven, and the devil can't have it. Hallelujah. Rebellion can't have it. Witchcraft can't have it. The powers of darkness. Hallelujah! I feel like shouting in this place right now. The more you fight, the quicker you're going to fight. The more you fight, the smaller things you're going to fight over. Oh, I this is a good preacher right now. But you'll be fighting, and if you choose to fight, you're going to fight the rest of your life, and sooner or later you're going to meet somebody bigger than you, somebody meaner than you, somebody, and you're going to fight somebody, and they're going to pull out a gun and blow your brains out, and it's going to be over. You'll do yourself a lot of good if you'll learn to turn the other cheek. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm not talking about letting people run over you. I'm not talking about being a pettish baby or a sissy. It takes a man to walk away. It takes a real woman to walk away. Somebody ought to tell the devil he is a liar. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
I can still see the light at the end of the tunnel shine through the dark times, even when I lose my mind. But it feels like no one in the world is listening, and I can't ever seem to make the right decision.
Somebody ought to tell the devil he is a liar. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Arnold Schwarzenegger with a M16 on his shoulder, that's not real life, friend. Stuff you see in Hollywood, that's not real life. It's all make-believe. It's real life. When Jesus is hanging on the cross and he said, forgive them, they don't know what they do. It's real life when they beat Stephen's to a pulp and he's crying, lay not this sin to their charge. It's real life. Hallelujah. When your flesh is wanting to blow up and you get by yourself, but I'm a man of God, I'm a woman of God. And this thing, Paul said, when I would do good, evil's always present. But I'm telling somebody, the more you walk away, hallelujah, heaven's going to smile down on you.
Time to say I told you so. Goodbye for now. So think the hardest part of holding on is letting it go. When will we sing a new song? A new song.
Favor of God's gonna fall out on you, and God will fight for you going in, and he'll fight for you coming out. And when the enemy comes in like a flood, you'll find the power of God in the Spirit of God, in the presence of God, and the anointing of God, in the touch of God. Hallelujah.
We just won't tell. I'm not the type to say I told you so. I think the hardest part of holding on is letting it go. I don't know what time it is, or who's the one to blame for this. Do I believe what I can't see? And how do you know which way the wind blows? 'Cause I can feel.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God's going to put people in your life that has a promise for you, and the devil's going to put people in your life that has a problem. Hallelujah. The enemy's going to put people in your life to pull you away from the plan of God and the will of God and the purpose of God. And every once in a while, you got to look at Hagar. Say, I may cry over you for a while. I may wipe a tear when I remember you, but I won't be back because I hear a promise calling me. Hallelujah. Somebody ought to worship him in this building. Hallelujah. Tell young people there's a call of God on your life. Hallelujah. I believe you can walk further than we've walked. I believe you can get closer. I believe God's ordained a ministry. And anointing to move at the end time, and I believe we're facing the end of time. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Some of us, we might be a David. We may be cutting the timber and laying up the gold, and you may get the one to build the house where the fullness of God dwells in. But there's going to be a move of God. There's going to be a touch of God. There's going to be a presence of God. And don't you sell out for what this world has to offer. Don't you sell out for what this world has to give. You ought to make up your mind. Love your hate me just so he loves me. If you're for me, against me, if God be for me, who can be against me?
They're struggling. They're struggling. Doesn't matter what they drive. Doesn't matter what kind of house they live in. People are hurting because you're listening to a man who's had billionaires in his services. I've had CEOs of major corporations in my service. I've had actors and singers in our services before. And you're up there preaching. You wonder, why on earth are they here? They got everything. Wonder what they're doing here. I want to tell you what they're doing there. They're struggling. Without God are empty. They're lonely. No joy, no peace, bitterness, selfishness, resentment, anger, sorrow, anxiety, depression, void of hope. The Bible says those who have not accepted Jesus Christ are going to hell. You can say that. They're eternally lost, John 3:36. Certain of hell, Revelation 21:8. Listen to this. But the fearful, unbelieving, abominable, murderers, whoremongers, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burns with fire and brimstone. They're awaiting judgment, Hebrews 9:27. That's why the man in Macedonia said, come over here and help us. We need a Savior to save us from this present world. Man, we're deteriorating all around us, guys. It's not getting better. It's getting worse. One of a kind. Jesus, God's only Son. Save me, Jesus, from the world around me. We're living in perilous times. Are not seen are eternal. Ravenhill used to say to me for several years, almost every single time I met with him, he said, focus on eternity. Psalm 105 verse 4 says, seek the Lord and his strength, seek his face evermore. Take it from the psalmist, my friend. Go after God. Don't let anyone stop you from pursuing Jesus.
What we've seen has been wonderful, what we've seen has been glorious, but there's got to be more, and we're in a place of desperation. We're in a place that we can't live the way we're living anymore. You know, in the early days of revival, we rejoice when people walk in under their own power, and then they're wheeled out in wheelchairs, whereas it should be by now that people are wheeled in wheelchairs and walk out under their own power. It should be that they're not new strip clubs opening up but closing down because there's no business. May not a single one escape your voice tonight. There's more, friends. We just want to sit back and skip a day of food and maybe pray for an hour and read our Bibles a little bit here and there and turn off the TV maybe once or twice a week to meet with God more, and we think the glory's going to come down. Can you really say, God, I'm desperate? Friends, let me ask you a question. How much room is there for God in your life? Are you desperate? It could be one person shut up alone with God that won't come out of their room until the glory comes down, and that could change a nation. I wonder, are we really willing to let God break our heart? God is seeking a hunger that will not let go because it cannot let go, a hunger that cannot quit because to quit is to die. That is God hunger. That is spiritual desperation. That is the key to revival. Longing for God. If the Lord is really with us, where then are the miracles and the signs and the wonders we heard about? If the Lord is really with us, where is He? I knew no one who had what I wanted. In fact, I did not know what I wanted. But I knew that if what I had was all the Christianity there was, the thing was a fraud. Whitfield used to pray, give me souls or take my soul. John Knox prayed for Scotland, give me Scotland or I die. John Hyde, the great intercessor, prayed with such intensity that when he came down sick in his 40s and was taken to a doctor in Bombay who was an American missionary in India, had moved to the center of his chest cavity. So much broken hearted anguish in his soul going up to God actually affected him on the inside. I ask you again, how much capacity is there for God in your life? What was wonderful a week ago and a month ago and a year ago is not wonderful today because the needs are still there. Because the sick are still there. Because the bound are still there. Because the oppressed are still there. Because our nation's still going to hell all around us. Something's got to change. I'm telling you, we may have gotten within an inch of the breakthrough, but we can't stop now. We can't settle for things being the way they are. But I tell you, we're stopping short. I tell you, we're trying to satisfy ourselves before the breakthrough comes. Sometimes it just hurts too much to carry the burden. Sometimes it's just too overwhelming to think of people going to hell. Sometimes it's just too discouraging to look at a sick person that's not healed. But I say, look at it, feel the pain, feel the burden, and then go after God till he uses you to set the captives free. Now's the point where we either seize the moment or look back with everlasting shame that we missed. Come on, friends, we've seen awesome things from God, but we haven't seen what we're supposed to see yet. If this book is true, if our God is true, we haven't yet touched what we're supposed to see. We've got a glimpse, but that's it. Let's not insult God by saying this is that yet. Youth workers, church leaders, evangelists, missionaries, young people, long-time believers, brand new converts.
It's gotten to the point that the fire that's absent from the pulpits today is telling on the pews. You could have a church of thousands and God's presence not be there. Numbers don't tell it. You could be 3,000 strong and a half inch deep. It doesn't mean anything. And a good wind that would come along and blow the 3,000 down because they have no root in them. Religious tapestries that we've come to be entertained by rather than empowered by. And all these kind of things are wearing off. And there's a heart cry coming out from the church saying, God, we need you. Got to have you. Don't want to move. Don't want to sing another song unless you inhabit it. What is God's move today? What kind of move is God involved in today? What kind of river is really beginning to flow? Where is it that God is doing the work? Where is it that God's doing? And he's doing it right here. He's raising up. He's looking for. He's seeking a people that are hungry and thirsty for him, his presence, who he is, not what he does, just who he is. And he's raising up a bunch of Moseses behind, a bunch of people with a heart of Moses that say, God, we're not moving unless you're here. That's when God says, yes, I've been waiting on that. God's crying for intimacy. Thank you. there comes a point in time when maturity should beckon us, and that maturity should call us up. There has to come a point in time that your heart cries out for something more than just another demonstration of His power. That you have to come to the point that you're looking for.